church starts at 9 a.m. There's a story behind that. When I was growing up, when I got to my teenage years that I could travel drive myself to church, I would always try to arrive just in time to miss the first song. And it would irritate my parents very much. And so to have my parents sneak in after the first song was an Easter miracle. Just a wonderful thing. No, don't say anything, Dad. It's all good. You don't have to say anything. It's all good. All right. Good morning.
Morning.
Christ has risen, amen.
Amen.
It is a joyous Easter Sunday here at First United Methodist Church. My name is Mike McVeigh. I am the pastor here, and it is just an absolute joy to have you in the house of the Lord this morning. We had an amazing sunrise service today, started the morning off right, and had a wonderful breakfast prepared by the Methodist men. I want to thank Russell and that crew for that. Let's hear it from them. And the day's not over yet. I know that we all got probably excited and events planned, Easter egg hunts, lunches, dinners, all the other stuff. But right now, we get to gather together. And we get to worship our Lord and Savior and celebrate His being alive today. Amen?
Amen.
All right. A couple of announcements this morning. Not too many. Don't want to bore you all that much. But this upcoming week, we will be having our grief share meetings continuing at 6 p.m. across the street at the Parsonage. The Methodist Midweek Mission will be on Wednesday evening from 5:30 for dinner. And then Bible study at 6 o'clock. Tax appointments continue on April 4th, and the United Methodist Men will be meeting for breakfast at 7 a.m. this upcoming Sunday at Sam's Restaurant. All right, so please be aware of that. This is really exciting. Coming up this upcoming Sunday at 11 o'clock, we will be beginning Children's Church. Once again, we will be having classes for the little ones. I believe it's 8 years old and under. Is that correct, Andrea? 8 years old and under. Any of the young people who want to, who are at our 11 o'clock service, they'll come, they'll worship with us, they'll have a hymn, and then they'll have a children's sermon, and then they'll go back and they'll have a project, a craft, and a worship song, and a little message. So it's going to be a lot of fun. But praise God that we are starting Children's Church back up again. Amen? That is a joy. That is a wonderful thing. Let's hear a little bit more joy for that this morning. Right? Yes, exactly. Thank you. So, all right. I do believe that is all of the announcements for this morning. We have a gift for you this morning. If you're walking out of the church today, each family, make sure you pick up a little pocket Jesus or a verse break bracelet for you to carry a little bit of Christ with you wherever you go. And little Jesus comes in a packet with a QR code. That QR code, there it is right there. That QR code is, if you scan it, will show you our church promotional video, our new church promotional video. So I encourage you to take a look at it after church. Okay, I don't want to be hearing the theme song there until after church, okay? All right. Well, brothers and sisters, for those of you that this is your first time or it's been a while since you've been to our 9 a.m. service, welcome. Glad to have you. But what we do in this service is we stand up and we greet those around us with the blessing and love of Christ, but we also ask the question, how can I be praying for you this week? Because we're not just a church that greets and smiles and handshakes. We're also a church that prays for one another. I know this is everyone's favorite time of the service. So let's stand up, not only pass the peace of Christ, but pass the prayer around.
What a beautiful family. I'm so happy to be here. Good morning.
Thank you.
close. Let's make our way back. Absolutely. Here we go. All right, Miss Andrea is going to help y'all with the children's sermon this morning.
Help us to remember
and to live
that
He is risen.
daughter while Andrea was giving a beautiful children's message, proceeded to take the bag of M&Ms and pour it on mom's lap and then begin to eat from it. So I think we're training her correctly. About to give. May they be a reflection of our love and faith in you. do with them as you see fit to serve this church and community. Amen. This morning, I have prepared a medley of all the songs my mom loves. Beautiful gospel music. My mom does not like gospel music.
Spaghetti salad.
morning where he was shouting out random food items. He is legitimately very grateful for spaghetti salad. You see where it comes from. It makes more sense. The more that my family comes to worship, the more this makes sense. So.
Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Russell. Appreciate that. Any other joys this morning? Joy to see those children up here this morning. Yeah. All right. Brothers and sisters, let's bow our heads in prayer. Merciful God, we give you thanks for this day, this glorious and wonderful day, that we may join in worship you, that we may share in our joy, share in our concerns, embrace one another in Christian love, and live as a reminder to the whole world of the empty grave of Jesus Christ. We do not gather at a graveside looking for a body. No, we go out into the world sharing that mystery of faith that Christ has risen. Christ will come again. I thank you for this day, and I thank you for each and every person here. As we pray the prayer you taught us to pray, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Our scripture reading this morning comes from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 24, verses 1 through 12. On the first day of the week, very early in the morning, the women took the spices they had prepared and went to the tomb. They found that the stone had been rolled away from the tomb. But when they entered, they did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. While they were wondering about this, suddenly two men in clothes that gleamed like lightning stood beside them. In their fright, the women bowed down with their faces to the ground. But the men said to them, "Why do you look for the living among the dead? He is not here. He has risen. Remember how he told you while he was still with you in Galilee? The Son of Man must be delivered over to the hands of sinners, be crucified, and on the third day be raised again." Then they remembered those words. When they came back from the tomb, they told all of these things to the 11 and to all the others. It was Mary Magdalene, Joanna, Mary the mother of James, and the others with them who told it to the apostles. But they did not believe the women, because their words seemed like nonsense to them. Peter, however, got up and ran to the tomb. Bending over, he saw the strips of linen lying by themselves, and he went away, wondering to himself what had happened. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Would you please bow your heads and pray? Merciful God, we ask you now to open our hearts and minds to the message, and that my words be yours. We ask this in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. I'm going to try to keep my sermon brief this morning, mainly because I think it is a habit of preachers when they have larger congregations than we normally do, stand and pontificate and try and speak in longer sentences and more eloquent words, because we don't usually have a crowd such as this. As a matter of fact, Easter is often referred to as Super Bowl Sunday for churches and pastors. That's usually because Super Bowl Sunday has less attendance than most average Sundays. Never understood that, by the way, but that's another conversation. No, today I want to simply ask you a question. Every Sunday of Easter, we come and we hear the same message. We read similar scriptures. We say things such as, "Christ the Lord has risen," all across our country and across the world on this day, Christians are gathering to celebrate a historical event that has yet to be accounted for. The tomb of Christ is empty. What do we do now? If you had come on Good Friday, many of you were here, my sermon was about how the apostles questioned after the crucifixion of Jesus must have been, what do we do now? You see, the apostles and the followers of Jesus did not believe he was going to rise from the dead. We know that because the women are going to the graveside with spices and oils to anoint the body and to prevent decomposition and bad smells. They're expecting to see a dead man. They're expecting to see a decomposing body of their rabbi. Instead, they find an empty tomb. And their first explanation isn't that Jesus rose from the dead. Their first explanation is that somebody has taken the body. And yet, these angelic beings appear and they are reminded once again. Humanity itself, we have to constantly be reminded, don't we? We have to have it constantly beaten into our brains. And they said, did you not listen? Obviously not. Did you not listen when he said that he would be handed over to be crucified and rise again 3 days later? I need you to understand something, friend, before we go any further. Dead people don't rise from the dead. Dead people don't rise. They stay dead. And there is only one moment in human history where an entire religious movement, an entire foundation of culture and faith and experience was founded on the simple fact that one man named Jesus Christ rose from the dead. Now, you don't have to believe that. But history has been yet to disprove what happened to the Nazarene on Easter Sunday. Governments and powers and authorities have tried for generations to disprove the empty tomb. And yet, here's the problem. The tomb is still empty. What do we do now? Is the question. What do we do now? Each and every person in this room has at some point had to encounter the fact of the empty tomb. Every person in this world, most likely at some point, will have to encounter the fact of the empty tomb. And you can either choose to believe that it didn't happen or it did. You can either choose to believe that Jesus Christ is still dead somewhere, or you have to believe that he was the Son of God. Because again, people don't rise from the dead. And the fact that we can say things such as, Christ the Lord has risen indeed, with such certainty, should boggle our minds. It makes no sense. Does Easter Sunday, does the empty tomb still surprise you? And if the answer is no, I would just remind you that the day we get used to the idea of Jesus being alive is the day that we have become used to and callous to miracles of the highest order. The question is, what do we do now? The wonderful thing to me about Easter Sunday is we usually have a lot of visitors. Now, I'm not saying that it's the people that come to church once a year. Usually who it is its family members, its friends, its people that have been invited. They come and they gather. Here's the wonderful thing about that. Each and every one of you are going to go back to some form of community. Each and every one of you are going to go back to your hometowns. You're going to go back to your family tables. You're going to go back maybe to your home churches because you're worshiping with grandma and grandpa this morning. You're going to go out somewhere after this. And the question that you're going to take with you is, what do I do now? Well, the angels told the women what to do. They said, go and tell the apostles what you have seen. Go and tell. Go before death unless you have actually truly believed you have seen something. My friends, do not let the empty tomb, that message which has changed lives and the courses of people's journeys for 2,000 years, don't let that message die at the Easter table after the service this morning. Don't let that inspiration, that anointing of the Holy Spirit upon you, wither away. The reason why we celebrate on Easter is to remind us of the miraculous possibilities that come through Jesus Christ. And that now that he has risen from the dead, so all of us have been removed from the finality of the curse of death. Jesus defeated death. He kicked it to the curb, stomped it in the ground, and said, anyone who seeks me, anyone who calls my name, shall have an empty tomb as well. There is only one thing we can do at this time, and we must do. If you believe that Christ the Lord has risen today, then go and live as though Christ the Lord has risen today. Let your life be a reflection of the empty tomb. It's not a complicated message. And again, I wish I could prepare something a little bit more eloquent. But I think the message stands for itself. The reading of that story stands alone. You don't need me to expound the impact of the empty tomb to you. You don't need me to translate the original Greek or go into long, cast out descriptions of the various theological ins and outs. All we need to know this morning is that Jesus is alive, that our Lord lives, and because he lives, we live also. Now let us go and live the empty tomb. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. And ask my communion stewards to come forward this morning. Before communion, I just want to say that in our tradition, this table is open to all of those who wish to partake. You do not have to be a member of our church. You do not have to be a Methodist. You must simply be a professing believer in Jesus Christ. And thereby we will accept you at this rail. As I say every Sunday, as you come seeking Christ, you will find him here. The way it is done is that a piece of bread will be torn apart and be handed to you, and then you may go to the altar. You'll also receive a cup of juice. You may go and then kneel at the altar, and you may take the bread and the juice. We drink juice in our tradition because, not that we have anything against wine, but interestingly, we believe that those of us who struggle with addictive qualities, we don't want to tempt them, so we use grape juice just to remove that issue, just to clarify. Maybe some of you Methodists didn't even know that this morning, but full clarity today. But again, I will invite you to come forward here in a few minutes. The night in which Christ gave himself up for us, he took the bread and he broke it. And he gave it to his disciples. And he said, take and eat from this, all of you. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. When the supper was over, he took the cup. He gave thanks over it and he gave it to his disciples. And he said, take and drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, put out for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me. Brothers and sisters, when we partake in Holy Communion, we reach our hand back through space and time and literally touch the hands of Jesus. For it was his hands that first passed the bread. It was his hands that first passed the wine. He was the one that instituted this beautiful tradition that we now come to take. Friends, the table is set. Come as you feel called. out of this song and have their leadership transferred over to our congregation. So just stick around. Don't go anywhere for right now. And if you're wondering, ooh, is that supposed to be me? Don't worry about it. I've already spoken with this individual, so it's all good. Oh gosh, is he going to call on me? All right. And our final song this morning, Someday's Coming. Y'all ready? By the word of God and the best of your ability in your life, and so answer, I will. And will you support this church with your prayers, your presence, your gifts, and your service? If so, answer, I will. Brother Gordon, welcome home. All right. Make sure you greet the Lord on the way out this morning. Brothers and sisters, the tomb is empty. Now go and live like it. Amen?
Amen.
All right. Have a great week. Go in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and all God's people say.
Easter!